Welcome to episode 201 of FBI Retired Case File Review with Jerry Williams. I'm a retired agent on a mission to show the public who the FBI is and what the FBI does through my books, my blog, and my podcast case reviews with former colleagues. Today, we get to speak to retired agent Gina Osborn, who served in the FBI for 22 years. In this episode, Gina reviews an assignment from early in her career in the 1990s when she worked on a Westminster Police Department task force targeting Asian organized crime in the Little Saigon district of Orange County, California. Gina and her Westminster PD partner, Detective Tommy Rackleff, known by Vietnamese gangsters as the old guy and the blonde, were successful in dismantling illegal video gambling, extortion, prostitution rings, and gang violence. Later in her career, Gina held many management-level positions, including supervising counterterrorism investigations in Southeast Asia and leading some of the Bureau's most significant national security and criminal computer intrusion investigations, such as the hack on Sony Pictures Entertainment. Recently, Gina and her co-host, Tracy Miller, a senior prosecutor, launched Behind the Crime Scene, a true crime podcast which explores the human side of first responders, investigators, and prosecutors, focusing on notorious cases which have haunted them their entire careers. In each episode, they deep dive into the world of some of the worst crimes in the U.S. history and show how these cases impacted the lives of the heroes who responded to them. So please stick around to the very end of my interview with Gina to hear more about her new podcast, which is out now and available wherever you get your podcast. This week's Behind the Crime Scene episode is an interview with prosecutor Bill Hodgman about the O.J. Simpson trial of the century. I just listened. It's great. So, how are you doing? I hope you're keeping safe and sane. I hope my podcast and my books continue to provide some type of comforting distraction for you. Next week, I have an extra episode coming your way. I'm just trying to give us all some more activities to do. So this month, you'll get 3 instead of 2 episodes of FBI Retired Case File Review. You're welcome. It's the recruiting one that I promised you about the intelligence analyst position and non-agent jobs with the FBI. And then the following week, I'll post an interview with former Jacksonville Special Agent in Charge, Jim Casey, who reviews a Detroit undercover case from the early days of his career. As for me, I'm just hanging out here in South Jersey. Yes, I'm still in South Jersey. Let me give you a few words of wisdom. Do not try to sell your house and move to another state during a pandemic. But we'll get through this. At least during the month of May, we have something to look forward to. My FBI and podcast swag and books mega giveaway for reader team members. It's still on. And if you received my May reader team email, you know all about the FBI silhouette target apron, the FBI challenge coins, the FBI mouse pad, and the podcast stickers and buttons, as well as print, digital, and audio copies of all of my books that could be yours. If you've joined my reader team, but you haven't been getting my monthly emails in your inbox, please add jerrywilliams@jerrywilliams.com to your email address book and contact list so my emails don't inadvertently end up in your spam filter or your promotion tab. I will be announcing the winners in my June reader team email. Plus, based on the good response I received, I will be hosting a live Zoom meetup on April 30th at 4 p.m. Eastern Time. So I hope you can come to the meetup and we can all cheer up each other. I'll send out another email or two between now and April 30th to remind you about the live Zoom meetup on April 30th. And I'll share the Zoom access link with you. I'm excited. I'm looking forward to meeting you in person, at least virtually in person. And of course, I want to welcome new listeners and invite you to join my reader team. This podcast is all about true crime, but if you're also interested in crime fiction, then once a month, via my monthly email, I try to keep you up to date on the FBI in books, TV, and movies. When you join my reader team, you get access to my FBI reading resource, which has a colorful list of more than 50 books about the FBI written by FBI agents who have been guests on this podcast. We have nonfiction, crime fiction, true crime, and memoirs. And of course, this month, Reader Team members get to participate in my 2000th episode mega giveaway. You can join my Reader Team on my website, or you can use the link in your podcast app's description of this episode. I would love it if you also check out my crime novels and my FBI nonfiction. I want to thank you for your support. Now here's the show. I want to welcome my guest, Gina Osborn. Hey, Gina, how are you?
Hi, Jerry. Thanks for having me.
We actually met on LinkedIn, and when I saw that you were going to be starting a new podcast, I had to reach out because there's not that many of us retired FBI agents who have podcasts, and I was just excited to hear what you're going to be doing.
I'm so glad I got to meet you. You have been doing this for a long time, and I appreciate all your guidance and help.
Well, your podcast is called Behind the Crime Scene, and it starts on April the 28th.
Yes.
I want to really encourage everyone listening to, after, of course, they finish listening to this episode.
Yes.
I encourage them to go to wherever they get their podcast and check out Behind the Crime Scene.
Thank you so much, Jerry.
Well, we'll talk a little bit more about the podcast and your co-host and why you decided to do it at the end of the episode. You know, I was looking over your bio and I saw so many things that you were fortunate to be able to do in the FBI. But we're together today to talk about the time when you were working in Los Angeles on a task force that targeted criminals that were in Little Saigon. You've selected three cases, but before we go into the details for each of those cases, why don't you tell me about how you got on that task force?
In 1999, I was a brand new agent out of Quantico. I had spent 6 years in the military working counterintelligence cases, espionage cases during the end of the Cold War. And I was assigned to the Los Angeles field office, and I was very fortunate to be assigned further, transferred into the Orange County Resident Agency. Actually, at the time, it was called the Santa Ana Resident Agencies. And I was assigned to a foreign counterintelligence squad, which back then also did domestic terrorism and international terrorism. This was before 9/11, when those things weren't the priority. And they also did applicants and civil rights cases. So a great big fat file, an old file, was dropped on my desk. I was the new guy. And it was an involuntary servitude case where Thai women were brought into the United States and they were forced into prostitution. So having the counterintelligence background, I knew absolutely nothing about organized crime, Asian organized crime, Asian prostitution, involuntary servitude, none of that. So I spoke to a few people in the office. There weren't very many experts, if any, real experts on the organized crime side when it came to Asian organized crime. So I went through the case file, Jerry, like every good agent does, and I saw a article where a detective from the Westminster Police Department rescued two Thai girls who are being held in servitude in the city of Westminster. So I thought, okay, I know nothing about this. And this detective, Tommy Rackleff from the Westminster Police Department, he knows everything about this. So I thought I would pay him a visit. So Jerry, I got into my 1988 powder blue Ford Taurus, government issued, one each. If you remember, I didn't have air conditioning. The engine would cut off whenever I stopped at a red light, but I was happy to have a car as a brand new agent in the FBI in Orange County. And I drove to the Westminster Police Department thinking I would find this Detective Rackleff. So let me tell you a little bit about the city of Westminster. It was home to Little Saigon, the Little Saigon district of Orange County. And Little Saigon was home to the largest Vietnamese population outside of Vietnam. Over 100,000 Vietnamese Americans lived there. And if you drop from the sky onto Bolsa Avenue, which was a street that ran right through the heart of Little Saigon, you would think that you were in the middle of Saigon or Hanoi, because most of the street signs were in Vietnamese. And it was really an interesting place, and I would learn later, because it was sort of, when it came to crime, it was the Wild West. It was an immigrant community. The violent gangsters that were working out of Little Saigon, they came from Vietnam, and the community was fearful of these gangsters, but they were fearful of the police as well, because where they came from, the police were corrupt, and they didn't trust law enforcement at all. So you had these gangsters, Vietnamese gangsters, targeting the Vietnamese community of Little Saigon. So it was really just high criminal activity, violent crimes, lots of different things going on there. And I knew absolutely nothing about this as I was driving down Bolsa Avenue on my way to the Westminster Police Department. What I also didn't know at that time was the Westminster Chief of Police absolutely hated the FBI. Apparently, there had been a shooting in his city that was witnessed by the FBI surveillance team, and he was the last to know about it. So not only didn't he want FBI agents in his department, he didn't want them stepping foot in his city. And he was prior to coming to Westminster, he was with the Los Angeles Sheriff's Department. He was this big and burly, very, very serious chief of police. And when I showed up to the Westminster Police Department lobby, I flashed my credentials and introduced myself to the front desk sergeant as an FBI agent looking for Tommy Rackleff. And needless to say, there was a little bit of a surprise by the sergeant who met me.
Tommy knew you were coming, right?
Well, I don't think I told Tommy I was coming.
This was like a drop-in visit. Oh, okay.
That's exactly right. I was young and I didn't know what I was doing yet. In fact, yes. So I just showed up. And I must have, like, I was out of the academy less than 30 days. So this kind of shows you where I was at. And so the desk sergeant, he went over to the watch commander to tell them that there was an FBI agent there. And then they called Tommy Rackleff over. And Tommy was an older, sort of weathered, wise detective. He walked up to the sergeant and the watch commander. All three of them looked at me like I was some form of crazy. And then finally, Tommy surrendered. He invited me in and took me back to this closet that he used as an office. And I think he sort of realized that I was brand new. I was a hard-charging FBI agent looking to make a case. And he knew that he had information that he could share with me. So he told me everything that I needed to know about Asian prostitution and organized crime that was being operated out of Little Saigon. And because he had worked there for over 25 years, he was sort of the old gray dog. And then he shooed me out the door, the back door, so that I wouldn't get caught by the chief, I suppose. And that was that. He had answered all of my questions and told me everything I needed to know.
Now, did he tell you anything about the chief and the relationship between his department and the FBI while you were there?
He did not. All he did was tell me what I was looking to know. And I told him a little bit about my main subject, who he told me that was a known pimp in town. So he was running brothels there in Little Saigon. So I thought I had struck gold, Jerry. I thought, here I have this expert at my disposal, and he seemed a little crotchety. However, he was still willing to share information. And I went back to my office. I dug up some more intelligence. I did a little checking, and now I had more information. And so the next day, I went back to the Westminster Police Department, and this time I called. And he hemmed and hawed a little bit, and he said that he would meet with me again. But this time, instead of taking me back to this closet that he had for an office, he wound up taking me to the chief's conference room. And he introduced me to his partner, Marcus Frank, who was an expert on Vietnamese organized crime. I mean, Marcus was a walking encyclopedia on everything that was going on around the world. He was an international expert.
Let me interrupt just for a second. Was there anybody in the FBI office that had worked cases in Little Saigon that had information?
So we had an organized crime squad at the time who had worked that, but that was a different squad. And I didn't really know a lot of the people on that squad. I did talk to a couple of people, but they weren't really working the Asian prostitution aspect of it. So really, that's why I decided to reach out and speak to the local partners.
That makes sense. Now, I do have to bring up one thing. You know, I've done this book where I talk about the 20 myths and misconceptions about the FBI. And number two was that the FBI doesn't play well with others. And so, you know, hearing this, you know, these issues between this particular chief and the FBI, you know, I can't wait to find out how this all turns out. I hope it has a happy ending.
No, it definitely has a happy ending.
Okay, great.
So Marcus hated the FBI, and it showed when we spoke to him. We were sitting down at the chief's conference table in the chief's office. It was just Marcus, Tommy, and myself. However, I continued to tell them what it was that I had learned about my main subject and what was going on in their city. But in the middle of our conversation, this huge man dressed in a pinstriped suit and a red carnation on his lapel interrupted the meeting. He was very, very not happy, I should say, and he told Marcus and Tommy to go with him. So I sat in the conference room alone for about 45 minutes. They came back and they said, all right, the chief will allow us to work this one case with you as long as you promise to share all of the information. So I'm thinking to myself, of course, I would be willing to share all of the information. And at that point, we were officially working with the chief's blessing on this Asian prostitution case. So what we learned about the organized crime group that we were looking at is that they were smuggling these Thai girls into the United States. And these young girls thought that they would come here to be hostesses or work at restaurants. And then by the time they got here, they were told they would have to be prostitutes and they would have to pay off a $40,000 smuggling fee. So they were indebted to the people who smuggled them over as well as the brothel owners. And so the $40,000 paid for the counterfeit passports, their travel, and all of their living expenses until they completely paid off the debt. So the main subject in my case that became our case was a man by the name of Chung Van Din. And he ran numerous brothels in the Little Saigon area. He would rent single family homes. So imagine living in a residential area and Chung Van Din comes in and rents the house right next door to you. He would put a mattress in pretty much every room and a couch in the living room. And he would use his Asian gangsters as part of his organization as security. And he would charge the patrons $100 to have sex with the girls. And the girls would have to do this until they paid off their entire $40,000 debt. So Tommy and Marcus and I worked together. We did a lot of surveillance to identify all of the different brothels in town, and Chung Van Din had several of them. We were able to identify the customers, and some of them we had turned into confidential informants. And I looked into the bank accounts and all of the bank records of Chung Van Din and learned that he had owned several homes in Little Saigon, which we were able to tie to the illegal proceeds. So the case was coming along well, and we wound up getting search warrants for a brothel and Chung Van Din's home. Jerry, it was so exciting for me as a brand new agent. These were my first search warrants, and I had invited a bunch of FBI agents from my squad to come out and work with me, and then half the Westminster Police Department, it seemed, was out there as well. So the FBI and the Westminster Police Department were working together great once again. And when we went into the brothel, Chung Van Den was there, and he had $13,000 in cash on him, mostly in $100 bills. We also went to his home, which we called the Pink House because it was painted pink, not too far from where this brothel was. And we found $100,000 in cash at his home, again, in $100 bills. So we were able to seize all of the money. We interviewed the young girls who were working in the brothels, but unfortunately, none of them would admit that they were being held against their will. You see, Jerry, they were scared for their lives because their family members were in Thailand, the organization, they had, you know, their arms everywhere. So they didn't want to say they were held against their will because they didn't want their family members to get hurt from Thailand. So we wound up arresting Chung Van Den. His bail was set at $1 million. And then there was nothing we could do with the girls because they didn't want to participate or be witnesses in the case. So we wound up having to turn them over to immigration. And the next day they were bailed out by the organization and they were sent to another city because we learned that these Asian gangsters had a circuit going. So maybe for 2 weeks, the girls would be in Little Saigon and then they would move to New Orleans. Maybe they would go to San Jose or Miami. So there were pockets of Vietnamese populations throughout the country and these girls would be on that circuit.
Is there a particular reason that they did that?
Just to make as much money as they possibly can, because they always wanted to have new girls in for the customers. They didn't want to use the same girls all the time. It was just part of the way they did business because there was always be fresh girls in all of these different brothels across the country.
When you're working this case and you see these women, you know, that you know are being victimized, and they're not cooperating, how do you feel? I mean, I would imagine that it's a disappointment that you're not able to help them.
Well, it was actually heartbreaking because you know that they are living under these horrible, horrible conditions, and yet they refuse to talk about it. And that was a problem, but it was motivating to me to take down that organization, to stop it from happening. So I think it really inspired me, you know, knowing, yes, it was hard. It was difficult to see these girls having to go into immigration and not be deported. They were bailed out by the organization the next day. However, I worked with agents in San Jose. I worked with agents in New Orleans, and we were all working together to take this entire organization out.
Even though you weren't able to, at that particular time, you know, help these women, I guess it was very satisfying that you were able to, in this case, with, you know, your subjects, the main subjects going to jail, and that the case ended, you know, on a positive note.
Yes, it absolutely did. And not only did we put the main subject in jail, but we also had his security people and other people within the organization go to jail as well. But there was just one little hang up in all of this case that I was known for a very long time. And that was when we went into the brothel and to Chung Van Den's home, I think two of the prostitutes and the main subject had tuberculosis. So all of the FBI agents on my squad, all of the Westminster police officers who were doing the searches, they all had to be tested for tuberculosis. So I wasn't very popular after that for a little while.
I hope you didn't get a name like, you know, TB Gina or something.
No, I did not. Luckily, well, I didn't hear that. They used to call me the blonde bomber in Westminster, but I never heard the TB one.
Yeah, you never know. We may find out now. Maybe somebody will call us and let us know that there was a nickname.
Yeah.
I really would like to talk because, again, the cliche that the FBI doesn't get along well with others is always, you know, in the forefront for me to debunk. And so if you could tell us what everybody got out of or gets out of working with the FBI. So it sounds like that the investigators, the detectives that you were working with already had knowledge about what was going on in Little Saigon. What did they get out of joining forces with the FBI? You know, you got intelligence. What did they get?
Can I talk about that in just a minute?
Yep, absolutely.
Good, yeah, because I get into that. So without anyone saying that they'd been held against their will, we had no federal involuntary servitude case. And Chung Van Din, although he had $1 million bail, he was bailed out. And within a couple of weeks, he was back in business. So then I started looking at the finances. And Chung was using the illegal proceeds to pay for his mortgage. And he also owned other residential homes in Little Saigon. And he was mailing his payments across state lines to the bank. So I was able to charge him with interstate transportation and aid of racketeering. And not only did we get to keep the money that we seized, which was $113,000, we were able to take all of the houses that he owned. And in order to take the head off of the dragon of the organization, you have to hit them where it hurts. And you know, Jerry, that's their finances. So we were able to take this organization out by taking away all of their assets. And that's when I started learning about asset forfeiture. And as part of asset forfeiture, you can seize all of these things. And I was able to give 80% of everything that we seized during this investigation to the Westminster Police Department so they could purchase equipment or send their officers to training. And on this case alone, with all of the houses and all of the cash that we seized, it amounted to hundreds of thousands of dollars that went into the purse of the Westminster Police Department to make their organization better. And so the next thing you know, the chief notices that, hey, the FBI has something to offer here, and everyone is working so well together, and this was such a huge successful case. He created an organized crime task force in the basement of his department, and he invited me to join. So the one thing, we learned several things by working together as we created this task force, and just on that case alone, is that we both had different things that we brought to the table. So there are different laws. There are the state laws and there are the federal laws. We had an assistant United States attorney and a district attorney assigned to the team because whenever we would open a case together, we would look at, okay, are we going to get more bang for our buck as far as more time in jail by going state? Or will we get better time if we go federal? So essentially, we learned how to sort of work together. And it wasn't easy all of the time, Jerry, because back then, this was in 1996, and the FBI wasn't allowed to record interviews back then. And we could record it as long as we had the special agent in charge to say that we could, to give the permission. And so that was something that was very sticky that we had to work through because the local police, they recorded all of their interviews. So if we were going to go state, we would have to record all the interviews, and that became a problem for my boss. So there were just little things that we had to work out, and eventually I got permission from the special agent in charge to record the interviews. And now it's something that the FBI does all the time.
That was pretty interesting. I had been talking about the fact that the FBI didn't record interviews. And sometime last year, I was doing an episode with another retired agent, and he corrected me to let me know that since I had retired, they were recording more interviews. Definitely custodial interviews where someone is under arrest. But I would imagine that still witness interviews are interviews where you're talking to, you know, people with a peripheral understanding of the case, that in those cases, that's a judgment call to just take a narrative report of those type of interviews. Is that correct?
Well, when I left the FBI, recording interviews I was here in the Central District of California, then the Ninth Circuit. So we pretty much recorded the majority of the interviews, if not all of the interviews that we did, working cyber.
Wow. I mean, that's definitely something that's changed, because it was always a question that was kind of difficult when people would ask, how come the FBI doesn't record their interviews?
Well, I can tell you it was a very big deal for this small task force. I was the only federal agent on the task force, the only FBI agent on the task force. And it was me and three detectives and a district attorney investigator. So there were five of us who were actually working it, you know, as investigators. And then we had our attorneys who were on board as well. But if we decided to take the case state and the detectives didn't record the interview and they have to go to trial, then that was a huge problem for them because it was routine for them to record the interviews. So that was one thing that we really had to work out, where I had to get permission to record the interviews with them because it was a sticky situation for them in the event we wound up going to state on those cases. So I had never worked at a police department before, and now I'm on this task force as a brand new agent, still on probation, working with these police officers. And I would roll in around 8 o'clock in the morning, and Tommy and Marcus and Kevin Baker, he was the third detective. I mean, they had been there for hours. And Marcus used to read the newspaper from cover to cover before I got there. And so any bad news relating to the FBI or bad press that the FBI may have received, he would make sure that he would bring it up when I walked in the door. So there was a little bit of the, I'm not going to say hazing because it wasn't really hazing, but they like to tease quite a bit the FBI. And so I wound up getting a plaque made that said Westminster Police Department, FBI resident agency, and I put it on my desk just so I could get back at Marcus. But I knew he liked me because if he didn't like me, he wouldn't be talking to me. So we wound up becoming friends after the fact.
What to me is really interesting is that not only are you on this task force with a police department that's a little wary about the FBI, but you're also, you know, a new agent who is just kind of finding her way as an investigator. So do you have anything to tell us either on a positive side, you know, what you learned from working with these detectives, or do you have any funny stories that kind of made you cringe at the time, but now you can kind of look back on it?
You know, I think what surprised me the most was being in that situation, being the only woman, being the only FBI agent, just the amount of confidence that I had going into that situation because I believed what I was doing. And I think that's where Tommy and I used to argue all the time. And it wasn't a bad arguing. It was just a banter, more of a banter back and forth, because he thought he knew everything, which he probably did. And I thought I knew everything, which I now realize that I didn't. But we just had a good time. And it was one of those things in law enforcement, there is such a camaraderie, you know, because you spend so much time with these people, you know, 12, 14, 16, 18 hours a day, you're with these people, they become your family. And I remember my report files at the FBI office, you know, about 10 miles away. And so every time I would do a report, I would have to take it over to the office in Santa Ana, and then they would file it and it would be in this file. And I would always forget to keep copies of my files. Whereas Tommy was so meticulous about everything. He had these binders above his desk. Every time he would do a report, he would do two copies of it. It would go into the binders. So I was always losing reports. He would always ask me for a report and I would never have a report. So one day I came in and they had given me a certificate of achievement for losing the most reports in the history of law enforcement, and they signed it Mr. Magoo. So that was one of the things that they did to me, among a variety of other things. And then there was one other time, and you can't do this now, Jerry, this was definitely back in the 90s, where I did not have a cell phone, but all of the detectives on the task force had a cell phone, and my boss had given me a cell phone that reeked of his cologne, but it didn't have an antenna on it. So they would call me, and they wouldn't be able to hear a word I said. So the chief felt sorry for me that the FBI wouldn't give me a cell phone. So the chief gave me a cell phone from his department. So I'm thinking, I have it made. I've got this cell phone. So after the first month of me having this cell phone, I come in and they had a big whiteboard over my desk. And there was a picture of me and there were little bubbles above my head. And I'm talking on the cell phone in this picture that they drew of me. Apparently, I had the second highest cell phone bill in the entire department.
Oh, my God.
So yeah, so they used to give me quite a hard time, but it was fun. I learned all my lessons and became a great FBI agent. Even if I do say so myself. But out of all of the people in this world who has my back, I know that Tommy Rackleff still has my back, and that's, you know, 20 years later.
Excellent, excellent. When I'm talking to new agents or talking to people interested in the FBI, they always ask me, what do you think is one of the best attributes to have as somebody wanting to go into the FBI? And I always say confidence. And I define confidence as going into a situation, having no idea what is going on, but having the confidence to know that you're going to be able to figure it out.
And those are the traits that the FBI looks for in all of its agents and analysts and professional support people, the people who are problem solvers, the people who are flexible. And one thing that I brought to the table was the collaboration, because I thought the best idea possible was for all of us in Westminster to work together, because that's where the community wins. If we're working in silos, it wasn't a good thing. So collaboration is a big thing too. It's all about relationships. And before 9/11, there were times when the FBI and the local police department didn't get along. 9/11 was sort of the leveler where everybody wound up having to get along no matter what, because our nation's security depended on it. But at that time, you know, there were still some holdouts where they didn't like the FBI. But we all worked really, really well together, and Marcus wound up coming along. But in the local setting, you never really know what's going to happen. You know, there are people who are coming into the police department to report crimes. And although we did have that with the FBI, it didn't happen as frequently as it did for the local police department. So one day we were sitting in the basement in our little area, little squad area, team area. And an individual came into the department saying that he was receiving threats from a loan shark. So this was the Benny the loan shark and David the executor case. Benny was a loan shark, and he worked out of the local card clubs out of Los Angeles. And he would charge his customers 10% interest per week. So if you borrowed $2,000 every week, you would be paying $200. Plus, you would have to put up collateral. And if you didn't pay, then David the executor, who worked for Benny, he would come and he would, I don't know, break your legs or do something very, very bad. So you had this sort of, and Asian gaming was big in the card clubs, so you would get a lot of people looking to loan sharks to borrow money. So one of Benny's customers, he had put his mother up as collateral for this loan that he got.
Wait. What? His mother?
His mother. So I told you, this is sort of the Wild West back in the day in Little Saigon. So this customer of Benny's had put his mother up. She and her husband had owned, I think, three different car lots in the Westminster area. The son didn't pay his loan back to Benny, wasn't paying his payment, his interest payment every week. And so Benny had David go over and knock on her door. So this woman was, I think, 83 years old. She didn't speak English, and she would spend her days listening to these Vietnamese prayer tapes on her little tape recorder. So David comes to her door, and David wasn't necessarily the brightest bulb in the club there. He knocked on her door and explained to her that, hey, your son put you up as collateral. He owes me this amount of money, and I'm going to take you if I don't get the money. And so this woman, she had the presence of mind to push record. And so we got all of this great evidence of David explaining how he worked for Benny the loan shark and what he was going to do to her if she did not pay. So then we happened to get another person coming in, and he was a total and complete gambling addict. And he was into Benny for tens of thousands of dollars, and he couldn't pay his 10% payment because he couldn't pay $1,000 a week. And as a result, David the executor was going to come and kill him. So we wound up getting this witness to become an informant, and we would send him into the card clubs and make payments to Benny and borrow more money from Benny so we can have the evidence with regard to how Benny's organization operated. At one time, this informant owed somebody $40,000. I mean, so this is big money we're talking about, that this informant, and he pretty much owed money to everybody in town. So One day, Benny and David, they weren't happy with the informant, and they were going to go and they were going to rough him up. And so we wound up having to take the case down. So they went to the informant's place of business. We were there. They had a big group of people with them, and at like midnight they showed up and we arrested them, and then we wound up doing the interviews. Took them back to the Westminster Police Department, put them in the jail cells individually, and we interviewed Benny, and I don't think he gave anything up, and we interviewed all of the other people who were there, and the last person that we interviewed was David the executor. So David came in and he had been sleeping. It's probably 3 o'clock in the morning by then, and we asked him, "So what do you do?" And he said, gave us the whole thing. He worked for Benny, the loan shark. They charge 10% interest. They get collateral. And when people didn't pay, he would go and he would rough them up. Then he said, "Okay, fine. Can I leave now?" And we're like, "No, I think we need to keep you around for just a little while longer." So I wound up, this was a Friday night or a Saturday morning, actually, at 3 o'clock in the morning. I, you know, wrote the affidavit up, and then he went to his court date on Monday. And he's reading the affidavit, and I'm taking him back to the marshals after he spoke with the judge, and he was shaking his head. And I said, "Well, what's wrong?" And he said, "I can't believe you told on me." So I don't know if he thought the blonde FBI agent that he was telling all of this to was just between us two, but yeah, he wound up going to a trial, and he got, I think, about 5 years in prison for being a executor for a loan shark.
That is wild that he didn't realize that he was providing a confession, because I'm sure that you read him his rights, but I guess.
Oh,
was,
yeah. Yeah. No. He was, I mean, he just thought he was going to be able to tell us what he did. And I honestly think that he didn't think what he was doing was wrong. I don't know what was in his head at the time, but I just remember walking him back to the marshals after his court appearance, and he couldn't believe it. He thought that I had completely betrayed him. And it was funny because I went to the jail for some reason, and this was maybe a couple of months later. We had a deal with the Santa Ana jail to house some of our federal prisoners, and I had to go to the jail to interview somebody or something like that. And this was after his trial, and he had already, I don't know if he was awaiting sentencing or what was going on, but he was there. And I was walking past a group of prisoners, and they all had to stand up against the wall and put their hands behind their back as I was passing by. And so I see David standing in the line, and I hadn't seen him for a couple of months. And he looked at me and he smiled, and then he remembered who I was. And then as the elevator was closing with me in it, I see him frowning because he remembered who I was. So. But yeah, poor David. I'm hoping that he went on to do good things after he got out of jail.
All right. That's not one of those stories where someone that you arrested became a friend.
No, not exactly. I don't think that's going to happen in this lifetime.
Well, you were saying that the case, you had to kind of take the case down a little earlier than you had planned to because of the threats that were being made to your informant. Was there something that you were still trying to get during that investigation that you weren't able to get, and did it, you know, have an effect on your case?
Well, we were trying to really get a good idea as to who all the loan sharks were working out of the card clubs. And so at that time, you know, we knew of Benny and we knew of a couple of others, but what we wanted to do was just do a one big takedown that the FBI likes to do all at the same time. So, you know, we don't really, you know, if we took one out, then everybody else would go underground. So I think we had identified a few at that time, and we were just waiting to get our cases really solid on the other ones. But when the informants are in danger, there are times when you have to take the cases down just so you can provide safety and security for the people who you're working with.
I know that we've discussed this a little bit, but I would think that for some people listening, they're very curious about your relationship with your own squad. Were you actually reporting every day to this new task force? Or did you go into the office at all? Did you have agents in the office that you were partnering up with? Or were most of the cases that you were working, were the Westminster detectives your partners?
Yes, the Westminster detectives were my partners. I reported every day to the Westminster Police Department. And this, in 1996, 1997, was highly unusual. Usually if there was a task force, the FBI would host the task force and people would come into the FBI space. Other police departments, they would send their task force officers to the FBI. But for me to go into another department and actually work outside of the FBI space, that was highly unusual. In fact, I remember the senior resident agent sending out an email to all of the agents in the office. And we had a pretty large office. I think at the time there were maybe 75 agents in the resident agency in Santa Ana. And he sent an email out to everyone saying that Gina Osborn is going over to work on a task force in Westminster. And make sure when you see her, you remind her who she's working for. So that was kind of the message that I got that I really needed to remember.
Wow. I was like you would forget, you know?
Exactly. And I represented very, very well at no point. I mean, I had been in the military before. I definitely knew who I worked for and who I represented. And I would often get into little tiffs here and there, defending the FBI and the task force full of people who like to kid me about it. But really, overall, I had the utmost respect for my partners. And I learned so much. I learned so much about investigations and so much about working with the local police and the value that they bring and the value that I brought from the federal government. But I remember there was one time where there was a shooting in Westminster where a couple of the police officers had a shootout with some bank robbery suspects. Tommy came to me and he said, Gina, we need to get these patrol cars out there because we need to transport these prisoners. I mean, this was an all hands on deck. And Westminster was a small department. They only had 100 and I think maybe 104 police officers, 104 sworn police officers at the time. So, you know, and to have a major shootout in their city, they needed all hands on deck. And so Tommy tossed me the keys to a patrol car and told me to drive it over to the scene. And I'm like, Tommy, there's no way I can drive this patrol car. I mean, I'm an FBI agent, and if that would be really bad if my boss knew that I was driving a patrol car around Little Saigon. And he's like, Gina, we need you to do it. You have to do it. We're not going to be able to transport these prisoners if you don't do it. We need this patrol car out there. So there I am driving over. I have my FBI vest on because I'm going to the scene of the shooting. And of course, the Orange County Register took a picture of the FBI agent getting out of the patrol car.
I knew you were going to say that. I don't know why, but I knew you were going to say that.
Yes. So I got an earful from my boss, my supervisor over at the FBI. I think he thought, and I was wondering if I was ever going to get off probation sometimes, but it was probably some of the most fun that I had because we made some huge cases. And,
you know, as you're talking to me about you working as an FBI agent at a police department, I can't help but think about Martha Dixon and Michael Miller, the two agents that were killed in the line of duty when they were working at the Metropolitan Police Department in Washington, D.C. And that was in 1994, just 2 years before, you know, you took this assignment. Was that ever brought up to you, you know, during your time there?
You know, it really wasn't. I mean, that was before my time that I came in. I mean, of course, I knew about it, but I was locked in the basement down there, and we were away from the public. But it was definitely a dangerous assignment because I was not Vietnamese. I was working in Little Saigon. I was a tall blonde. So pretty much wherever I went, I mean, people knew us. They knew who the police were. And I had arrested a lot of people. So in fact, one time, Tommy and I had gone out to arrest a gangster at a Vietnamese cafe. And we went in looking for him, and he wasn't there. And we went back to the department. Didn't think anything of it. We'll find him later. And Tommy gets a phone call from the owner of the Vietnamese cafe. And she said, what were you doing in my cafe? Tommy is kind of perplexed by this. He goes, well, how did you know it was me? Because we didn't identify ourselves to anybody. And she said, well, my sister said it was the old guy and the blonde. And so we knew it was you. So we were known in that community as being part of this task force. And so, yeah, so it was definitely something to think about whenever we were out on the streets doing our work.
Well, I have to let everybody know that you sent me a picture of the two of you together, the old guy and the blonde. So if they're interested in in seeing the dynamic duo, the picture will be with the show notes for this episode.
Oh, very good. And you know what's sad is that he was probably my age when I met him. Now, he's well into his 70s now, but for our group, he was the old gray dog.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
So we're like the old dogs now,
too. I know. Exactly. Exactly. So the last case I'll tell you about, because this was right before I wound up transferring out of the Santa Ana RA, it was called Operation Wildcard. And it was the Pomona Boys gang. And the leader of the Pomona Boys gang there in Little Saigon, his name was Sonny Nguyen. And he was operating the country's largest Asian organized crime syndicate, involving international ecstasy trafficking, loan sharking, illegal gambling. I remember there was extortion going on. So there, he was just, I mean, a bad guy. So we, you know, the other things were pretty much cut and dry. We had already worked loan sharking, you know, drug trafficking, that was pretty cut and dry. But the illegal gambling part of it was very interesting because in Little Saigon, they had these Vietnamese cafes. And so they were just coffee shops. And you would have younger girls who were the coffee shop hostesses, and they were wearing negligees. So you would have these older Vietnamese men and the gangsters. They would all go to these coffee shops to see these half-dressed girls and get their coffees and smoke their cigarettes. And they had these tabletop video games. So if you remember back in the day, Jerry, the like Pac-Man games that had the glass tabletop that you would play. Each of these machines cost about $2,500, and they would be a Pac-Man machine, and then they would convert, when you put money into it, to a gambling machine. And the gambling game was called Dancing Dolls. So they would insert their money into the machines, and if they win, they would get paid by the cafe owner their winnings. So it was just another way to gamble there in Little Saigon. And each of these machines would bring in about $150,000 in revenue. And there were machines all over in all of the Vietnamese cafes. So this was, you know, $1 million money-making conspiracy that they had going on. So the cafe owners, they had this remote that looked like a garage door opener. So that if the police came in to kind of walk around the cafe or do whatever they needed to do in the cafe, while the patrons were playing their Dancing Dolls games, they would see the police coming in, they would click this remote, and the remote would convert the Dancing Dolls game back to the Pac-Man game. So they were very clever when it came to hiding this illegal gambling from the police. However, we were able to figure this whole thing out. We were able to figure out the signal that was on the remote device. So whenever we would go in to raid a cafe, the owner would convert the game to a Pac-Man machine, and then we were able to convert the game back to the Dancing Dolls game. So essentially, this was a RICO case that we had because we were using all of the different predicate offenses to do one big conspiracy case on Sonny Nguyen's entire organization. And we had a wiretap on Sonny's phone. So that was another thing that I brought to the table in addition to, you know, maybe money laundering or asset forfeiture or the other federal statutes that I could use. We also had a wire room in the Santa Ana RA, and I could go to the federal judge to get permission to get a wire up. And we had a wire up on Sonny's phone and a variety of his associates' phone. So we had been up for a while, and we were listening 24 hours a day. And one day there was a shooting in a Vietnamese cafe, and it was one of Sonny's Pomona boys, one of his associates in the Pomona boys gang had gotten shot by another gang member. And so Sonny wanted to retaliate. So we're listening to Sonny all day long. You know, he's trying to get a gun. He had a guy up in San Jose that was supposed to bring him a gun because he was going to go and shoot the shooter who shot his guy. So all day long, we're hearing about what's going to happen next. The associate from San Jose comes down. We find out that the shooter's at the Commerce Casino, which is up in Los Angeles, which was north of where we were in Orange County. And so he was keeping track of the whereabouts of this rival gang member. So it's probably midnight, and we hear that the guy from San Jose is in town. We have surveillance on the guy from San Jose. He checks into a motel. We hear what motel he's going to be checking into over the wire. And then abruptly we hear that they're done for the night. So we've been out for probably 15 hours at this stage in the game. And we're all kind of talking the surveillance team about, okay, who's going to stay on the motel? Who's going to stay on Sunny's house? What are we going to do? When all of a sudden we see the guy from San Jose come out of his motel room and get into his car. So we're back on. He goes over to Sunny's house. We see Sunny getting into the car. And now we know where they're going because they get onto the freeway and they're heading north. So we've got the gun, we've got Sunny, we've got the guy who's going to get shot up at the Commerce Casino. We called in the Westminster Police Department, our partners, they have their patrol cars, and they wound up shutting down the 22 freeway, getting Sunny out of the car, proning him out on the 22 freeway, and finding the gun that he was going to use to take out his rival gang member. So that was another case that we had to stop in the middle of it because if we didn't, then there would have been a shooting, a drive-by shooting. But, you know, the Westminster Police Department, they had the resources. And I'll tell you, Jerry, that was probably one of the best moments in my law enforcement career, was able to see Sunny Wynn proned out on the 22 freeway and taken into custody.
It does seem like even though you had to stop the investigation early, you were still at a point where you had sufficient evidence, you had gathered enough intelligence that you were still able to make the case.
We wound up going RICO on the case, and we arrested a lot of people. I don't remember exactly how many, but it was probably between 20 and 30 people that we wound up taking down as a result of that conspiracy.
Well, I have to ask you, because you know, you've mentioned many times about the fact that your targets all being Vietnamese, Asian drug gang members, and that you're operating your investigation throughout Little Saigon, that the old guy and the blonde kind of stand mm-hmm. out. So how much of what you did involved informant information? For instance, in the games that you mentioned, the gambling games, you talk about how you figured things out, but you know, how much of that really was information from cooperators, and how were you able, if that's the case, how were you able to convince somebody, you know, in that community, in the Vietnamese community, to work with
you? It wasn't easy, but we were out there every day doing our investigations, doing interviews with people, identifying people who could be informants, and really what we were trying to do, and they saw what we were trying to do, was make their community better, because there were so many good people living in Little Saigon who came to America to live the American dream, not to be tormented by gangsters that had also come to this country. So that was one thing. And I worked on this team for about 5 years. And that was the message that we were sending, that we're trying to help the community. And we, in turn, got a lot of help from the community because they saw what we were trying to do. But a lot of the people didn't speak Vietnamese. So we had our DA investigator was Vietnamese. So he would translate for us. And then we also had a woman who was a public safety officer that was assigned to our team who was Vietnamese, and she would translate for us as well. But when we would do our interviews, or if we would do an interrogation or what have you, we would have to have one of those people in. A lot of the younger folks spoke English. Sometimes they would pretend that they didn't speak English, but we were able to overcome that hurdle. You would be surprised. I mean, you know how many talented people are in the FBI. On the brothel case, we happened to have a FBI agent a Caucasian FBI agent who spoke fluent Thai and Cambodian in the office. So imagine that. And then another Caucasian FBI agent who spoke Vietnamese on my squad. You know, the FBI, they hire the best and the brightest. So we were very, very fortunate to have those resources so easily accessible to us.
So you had just mentioned that you were on this task force for about 5 years. It was so successful. Why'd you leave?
I left because 9/11 happened. And of course, you know, Jerry, that after 9/11 happened, our priorities changed in the FBI, and terrorism became the number one priority, followed by counterintelligence, followed by cyber. And so I really wanted to work terrorism, and I wound up getting promoted to a supervisory position. I was the counterterrorism program coordinator, and then later became the extraterritorial squad supervisor in Los Angeles, where we had a squad of agents that would work terrorism investigations against U.S. persons and U.S. interests in Southeast Asia. So I was the supervisor on that squad as well as the counterterrorism program coordinator before I wound up going to headquarters.
And what did you do at headquarters?
I was on our inspection staff, and I was a team leader on inspection staff. So the FBI inspects itself, and every 3 years, each FBI office gets an inspection. So that means that people from headquarters and supervisors from all around the FBI will go to the field office and we'll look at their leadership and their cases, how they're spending their money, how they're utilizing their resources. So really it's a top to bottom inspection to make sure that the FBI office is doing what it should be doing and they're effective and efficient at doing what they're doing.
I remember the inspections well. As a matter of fact, 1 year I just happened to be the acting senior resident agent in our Cherry Hill office during the 6 months leading up to the inspection. And I think that was the time where I decided I didn't want to be a supervisor.
It was a lot of work, you know, Jerry, but I am a very social person. I don't know if you can tell that, but I really enjoyed it because every 2 weeks I was anywhere USA on inspection, leading a team of people. And every 2 weeks I was back in Washington, D.C. getting ready for the next inspection. So in total, during my entire career, I probably participated in over 30 different inspections, which some people would in the FBI think I should have my head examined. But I just really enjoyed it because I felt, although it's painful, I felt that we were helping the FBI become better.
You still ended back in LA. So how did that happen?
Well, while I was on inspection, none of the team leaders had any technical background or technical expertise. And I was one of those people that didn't have technical expertise. However, we had these cyber squads that needed to be inspected. And so I volunteered to inspect the Chicago field office's cyber program. And I learned so much during that inspection. I think that was a 3-week inspection. And I sort of became a program expert on cyber because they kept choosing me to go out and inspect these cyber programs. So in 2007, Los Angeles created the first full-time cyber and computer forensics assistant special agent in charge position. And right as I was coming back to Los Angeles after my 18-month temporary duty where I was eligible to go into the executive ranks, I wound up getting that position. And the last 11 years of my career, I had the privilege to be the cyber ASAC and computer forensics ASAC for Los Angeles.
Excellent. This podcast also gives me an opportunity to try to recruit. What people are always interested in learning is, you know, how my retired agent's guest got into the FBI in the first place. Could you tell us when you joined the FBI and why you joined the FBI?
Well, gosh, I'm going to have to go back to high school because when I was in high school back during the 80s, I was absolutely fascinated by the Cold War. Anything relating to the CIA and the KGB, the Soviet Union, I just consumed anything that I could read about that. And I wanted to work for the CIA. That was my goal. So I'm in my second year of college, and I needed a 4-year degree in order to work for the CIA. And a young man came up to me in the library of the college and started telling me about the Army's counterintelligence program. And my father was a Marine. Never in a million years did I ever think I would ever join the Army, but he was telling me how the Army could pay for my college. I could live in a condo. I mean, it was a total Private Benjamin thing, Jerry. If you remember Private Benjamin, that's what it was. He was telling me the best of the best. I could live in Europe. I can chase spies across Europe. It would be a great and amazing thing. So the next day, I was wearing my black and white polka dotted dress and a fuchsia hat. And I went down, this was the 80s, I went down to the Army recruiter's office. They looked at me like I was crazy. I tested off the charts for the test that you take in order to get into the Army. And 8 months later, I was eating dirt in basic training in Fort Jackson, South Carolina. And I wound up in Europe for 6 years conducting espionage investigations. And so when I finished my tour, I decided to go into the FBI instead of the CIA, and I wound up joining the FBI in 1996, and it was the greatest experience of my life.
That just talks about the uniqueness of the FBI, because at the time you wanted to devote your career to espionage cases, and if you had gone into the CIA, that would have been the only direction that you could go in. But here you end up working that initially, and then working, you know, organized crime, Asian organized crime, and then next thing you know, you're working cybercrime and forensics. So, you know, you have an ability in the FBI when you join to look at all kinds of different violations and programs instead of just one particular career path.
Absolutely. I agree with you 100%. And in 2016, this is a crazy story. I wound up back at Quantico as a counselor, because my counselor, just so if people are aware, I don't know if you've talked about this on your show, but every class at Quantico has two counselors assigned to it. And these are agents out in the field who go to Quantico and pretty much live with this class to help them get through the academy and to give them great wisdom and do all those things. And my class counselor had done that at the end of his career. And I wound up thinking to myself, you know, I'm getting ready to retire. This is something that I really want to do. It was highly unusual for an assistant special agent in charge to go to Quantico and do this. However, I couldn't find any of my people. I had to send somebody from my program. Nobody wanted to leave their families for 6 months. So I said, okay, I'm not going to ask anybody to do anything that I wouldn't be willing to do. And I wound up going and doing this. And I'll tell you, the talent that I saw, and this is one of the things that I was looking for when I did this, I was so impressed with the talent of the new agents going through the academy right now. I mean, we had PhDs in our class. We had military heroes, law enforcement, other agencies. We had a zookeeper that was in one of our classes. So the FBI really takes people from all different walks of life. And that's what I think makes the FBI so great, because the average age still is 31 years old going through the academy. So we get these people in their second careers who have so much to offer the American people and in this country to do what we do.
I have talked about being a class counselor before and admitted that if anybody asked me if I had any regrets of, you know, something that I didn't do while I was in the FBI, that regret would be not having gone down to Quantico to take a class through. But, you know, that was during the same time period that my kids were in high school and my girls were big basketball players. And, you know, just the thought of, you know, missing any of their games and not, you know, being there in the stands for them. I wasn't able to do it, but definitely what a rewarding opportunity, especially at the end of your career when you have so much experience and knowledge to give back.
I was so proud, and I'm not a crier, but I must have, I think I cried more at Quantico during the time I was a counselor, because I was so proud. I was so proud, and we called them kids, but these are all grown-up adults who have these amazing backgrounds. But they were our kids, you know, they were our kids and to take care of and get them through. And they worked so hard. And it's not an easy academy to get through because there are so many moving parts and you have to do so many things while you're there. But I'll tell you, yeah, I was just so impressed with those young people and what they have to offer. And it was good for me to see that before I retired from the FBI.
Well, one thing that I can say is that in doing this podcast now, going into my fifth year, that I do feel that I have had some of that opportunity, because I've been able to speak to so many people who are going through the recruitment process, the application process, and, you know, to get to know them, to cheer for them, to, you know, follow their career paths into the FBI. So I do feel a little bit of pride in knowing that this podcast has, you know, helped them even just a little bit in knowing that their career choice is one that is definitely going to be something that's going to be satisfying for them as they listen to, you know, the careers of my guest.
And if you are a woman listener, please consider it. I never in a million years ever thought that I would go into the military. I never, you know, you just, if you think that that's not something that you can do, it is something you can do. Go to the FBI website. We definitely need more strong women to join the ranks of the FBI.
All right. So when did you retire?
I retired in 2018.
We are going to talk about this new podcast, but what else are you doing? What are you doing now?
I am actually writing for Hollywood. That's something that I always wanted to do when I was young. I used to, in elementary school and junior high school, I would write Laverne and Shirley and Happy Days episodes for fun. So I always wanted to write for television and write for film. And so I am working on a couple of projects doing that. I'm doing this amazing podcast that I'm having an absolute ball doing. So I understand why you enjoy doing this so much. And I am writing a book that maybe I'll come on and tell you all about that as soon as we get closer to that being published.
Wow. And is that a memoir?
It's sort of a cross between a memoir and a self-help book.
All right. You're already on the tickler to come back and talk to us about that book when it is published. But let's spend a little bit of time talking about the podcast. And of course, the first question, because it's the question I'm always asked, why? You know, why did you want to do a true crime podcast? And what is going to be your focus?
Well, it's called Behind the Crime Scene, a true crime podcast. And it is a podcast that will explore the human side of first responders, investigators, and prosecutors. And it really it focuses on the notorious cases that they worked. But what we like to do is talk to these people and really get an understanding about how they felt while they were working these big cases and really get a behind the scene look that people don't really hear about in the news.
And who is we?
My partner in crime, her name is Tracy Miller, and she has been a prosecutor for 24 years. And we were introduced to each other by the sheriff of Orange County, former sheriff of Orange County, Sandra Hutchins. And we just have so much in common. She does a lot of amazing things with public speaking, and she has this incredible career. So we thought it would be interesting to have an investigator and a prosecutor talking about these cases so you can see both sides of what we deal with.
I think one of the unique things is going to be law enforcement authority about what it takes to investigate and prosecute a case, but that authority coming from two women. I think it's a unique look at, you know, this type of a podcast that no one else will be offering. There are many podcasts, of course, true crime podcasts that are hosted and produced by, you know, women, but you both were in the trenches. I mean, you're talking from a place of authority, and I think that is so unique and so refreshing.
Well, thank you, Jerry. And we were both executives as well. So we both rose up the ranks in each of our organizations. And then the interesting thing about Tracy is she started her career as a law clerk on the O.J. Simpson case. So that's how she started with a bang. So we have a really interesting episode coming up with Bill Hodgman, who was Marsha Clark's boss, and he goes behind the crime scene to tell us what was going on at that case, and he talks about the crime scene and what he thinks happened there.
All right, so to make sure that everyone has the opportunity to check your show out, I also will make sure that I have all the links to your website so that they can check out the show. So at the end of each episode, I'd like to give my guests the last word. So what would you like to say?
I'd like to end with a quote by Albert Einstein. He said, "They who attempt the absurd can achieve the impossible."
And that's the end of the interview. At jerrywilliams.com, you'll find a photo of Gina Osborn. You'll find a photo of Gina Osborn with her Westminster PD detective partner, the old man and the blonde. There are also links to newspaper articles about the many Asian organized crime cases the two of them worked together in Little Saigon. And of course, there is a link to Gina's new podcast, Behind the Crime Scene. Please check it out. It's fantastic. I hope you enjoyed the interview and that you'll share it with your friends, family, and associates. If they're not sure how to listen to a podcast, have them read the post on my website, How to Listen to a Podcast, and subscribe to FBI Retired Case File Review on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, your favorite podcast app, and also YouTube. I'd love it if you also check out the link to my books in your podcast app's description of this episode. My nonfiction, FBI Myths and Misconceptions, A Manual for Armchair Detectives, which goes through 20 cliches and misconceptions about the FBI in books, TV, and movies. And there's also my word search puzzle book and my Philadelphia FBI Corruption Squad crime novel series. All of my books are available wherever books are sold as ebooks, paperbacks, and audiobooks. Please consider leaving a review. Reviews help readers find good books. Thank you for listening to the very end. I hope you come back again for another episode of FBI Retired Case File Review with Jerry Williams. Thank you.